Hello, I'm Dr. David Spach from the University of Washington. In this National HIV Curriculum mini-lecture, I'm going to provide an overview of the mechanism of action of HIV entry inhibitors. There are multiple classes of HIV antiretroviral medications that target different points in the HIV lifecycle. This talk is going to focus on HIV entry inhibitors, which I think are conceptually the most difficult medication class to understand. This talk will review the HIV entry process and address the distinct mechanism of action of each of the four subclasses of HIV entry inhibitors. The goal of this talk is for you to understand how each of the HIV entry inhibitor medications block HIV from entering the host cell. The targets for the HIV entry inhibitors are unique in that some bind directly to HIV, whereas others bind to the human cell. The medications that target HIV bind to the HIV envelope glycoprotein, whereas those that target the host cell bind to a receptor on the surface of the cell. So as we go through this, it's important to keep track of whether the medication is targeting HIV or targeting the host cell. Let's start by looking at the HIV glycoprotein target. The HIV envelope glycoproteins are located on the outermost part of the virus. The HIV envelope glycoproteins are the target for two of the HIV entry inhibitors. To get a more detailed look at the HIV envelope glycoprotein, let's zoom in on one. The HIV envelope glycoprotein is a trimer structure containing three monomers. Each of the monomers contains a GP120 and GP41 subunit. One of the HIV entry inhibitor medications targets GP120 and another targets GP41. Now, let's look at the other target for HIV entry inhibitors, the host cell surface receptors. As shown here, there are many human cell surface receptors that may be utilized by HIV to enter the cell. Normally, these receptors function to play a key role in the host's cellular immune responses. There are two host cell surface receptors targeted by the HIV entry inhibitors, the CD4 cell receptor and the CCR5 co-receptor. Now that we have established the targets for HIV entry inhibitors, let's briefly review the sequential steps in the HIV entry process and examine at what point these antiretroviral medications work during HIV entry. There are three main steps involved in HIV entry. First, HIV attachment to the host CD4 receptor. Second, HIV binding to a host cell co-receptor. And third, fusion of the HIV membrane with the host cell membrane. The HIV entry subclasses are based on the three main HIV entry steps. Attachment inhibitors block CD4 attachment, CCR5 antagonists block co-receptor binding, and fusion inhibitors block the fusion of the HIV and host cell membranes. In addition, there's one more subclass of HIV entry inhibitors, the post-attachment inhibitors, which you can think of as acting after CD4 attachment, but before co-receptor binding. There are four FDA-approved HIV entry inhibitors, fostemsavir, ibalizumab, maraviroc, and enfuvertide. As you can see, there's one HIV entry inhibitor medication for each of the four entry inhibitor subclasses. Okay, now let's take a closer look at each of these medication subclasses, beginning with the subclass of entry inhibitors, the attachment inhibitors, that act at the earliest point in HIV entry. As HIV approaches a cell, the first interaction that typically occurs is the attachment of the HIV envelope glycoprotein with the host cell CD4 receptor. Looking at this more closely, the outermost component of the HIV envelope, GP120, has a region known as the CD4 binding site, and this is the region that interacts with the host CD4 receptor. As shown here, since the HIV envelope is a trimer, the HIV attachment process typically involves binding of multiple GP120 with CD4 receptors. Fostemsavir is an HIV attachment inhibitor. Note that fostemsavir is a prodrug that is converted to temsavir, which is the active form of the drug. Temsavir binds to HIV GP120 near the CD4 binding site. This binding prevents the normal GP120 conformational change that is required during the attachment step. Fostemsavir is the only available HIV attachment inhibitor. Fostemsavir is an oral prodrug dosed 600 mg twice daily, and it can be taken with or without food. In the GI tract, the enzyme alkaline phosphatase converts fostemsavir to the active moiety temsavir. Next, let's look at the post-attachment inhibitor subclass of HIV entry inhibitors. Following HIV attachment, the HIV GP120 undergoes restructuring whereby the V3 region migrates distally towards the host cell membrane. This fluid movement within GP120 is essential for HIV binding to the host cell co-receptors. The post-attachment inhibitor ibalizumab is a humanized monoclonal antibody, and it binds to the host cell CD4 receptor at the domain 2 region. This binding does not block attachment, but it prevents the conformational change in the GP120 that is needed for the GP120 to bind to the host cell co-receptor. Since this step occurs after attachment, but before co-receptor binding, this medication is considered a post-attachment inhibitor. It's important to note that ibalizumab binds to the D2 region of the host cell CD4 receptor, and this does not interfere with the normal functioning of the D1 region, which is important since the D1 region is involved with receptor binding to major histocompatibility or MHC class 2 molecules. Thus, ibalizumab blocks HIV entry while preserving normal immune function. Ibalizumab is the only available HIV post-attachment inhibitor. Ibalizumab must be given intravenously, with an initial loading dose of 2,000 mg, followed by 800 mg maintenance doses given every 2 weeks. Now let's look at the HIV co-receptor inhibitor subclass of entry inhibitors. As shown earlier, the second step in HIV entry, co-receptor binding, involves binding of the HIV GP120 V3 region with the host cell co-receptor. The host cell co-receptor most often involved in this process is the chemokine co-receptor 5, which is commonly referred to as the CCR5 co-receptor. The medication maraviroc can block HIV entry by binding to the CCR5 co-receptor. Maraviroc is usually referred to as a CCR5 antagonist or a CCR5 co-receptor inhibitor. As shown here, when maraviroc binds to the CCR5 co-receptor, it causes a conformational change in the co-receptor, and this altered CCR5 co-receptor is no longer receptive and able to bind with the HIV GP120 V3 region. Maraviroc is the only available CCR5 antagonist. Maraviroc is an oral medication that is taken with or without food and is usually given at a dose of 300 mg twice a day. Note, as shown in this table, the dose may need to be adjusted with concomitant administration of a CYP3A inhibitor or inducer. The use of maraviroc is a bit more complicated since you first have to do a special HIV tropism test to determine if maraviroc is likely to work. So let's step back and review the concept of HIV tropism. This is a bit of an oversimplification, but HIV tropism can be thought of as the type of HIV based on the host co-receptor used to enter the cell. The host cell co-receptors can be thought of as two different pathways for how HIV can enter into the host cell. The two main co-receptor options for HIV are the CCR5 co-receptor and the CXCR4 co-receptor. The composition of the HIV GP120 region determines what HIV co-receptor pathway HIV can use to enter the host cell. So just to clarify, what we refer to as HIV tropism is based on the HIV structure. When the structure of the HIV GP120 region dictates that HIV will use the CCR5 co-receptor, the strain of HIV is considered as R5 tropic HIV, or R5 HIV for short. This is also sometimes referred to as CCR5 tropic HIV. Using an analogy here, you can think of this as a right-handed HIV. In a similar fashion, when HIV uses the CXCR4 co-receptor, we refer to it as X4 tropic HIV, or X4 HIV for short. These are also sometimes referred to as CXCR4 tropic HIV. Following along with the analogy, you can think of this X4 tropic HIV as a left-handed HIV. There are also some strains of HIV that have the ability to use either the CCR5 or CXCR4 co-receptor. These are known as dual tropic HIV, and you can think of these as ambidextrous strains of HIV. Last, there are some individuals with HIV that have a mixture of the R5 tropic and X4 tropic strains, and we refer to these as mixed tropic HIV. This is like having both right-handed and left-handed HIV strains. It's very important to understand that Maraviroc is effective only when a person has pure R5 tropic HIV. As shown here under the purple bar, with all X4, dual, and mixed tropic types of HIV, if the CCR5 co-receptor is blocked by Maraviroc, HIV can still enter the cell by taking the path of least resistance via the CXCR4 co-receptor. For the last subclass, let's review HIV fusion and explore how the HIV fusion inhibitors work. Fusion is the final step during HIV entry into the host cell. The fusion process is initiated after the HIV GP120 has bound to both the CD4 receptor and the host co-receptor. The binding to the co-receptor triggers the HIV GP41 to spring open from a folded state. This extended conformation of GP41 locks onto the host cell membrane. When the GP41 springs open, the HIV GP120 glycoproteins are cast off, and then they're no longer involved in HIV entry. Next, the HIV GP41 then folds back on itself, which has the effect of pulling the HIV membrane closer to the host cell membrane. After several of the HIV GP41 get involved in this process and fold, the two membranes get even closer together and start to fuse. As the HIV and host cell membranes fuse, this creates an alleyway for the HIV core to begin entering the host cell. Once the HIV core penetrates into the cell, the HIV entry step is finished, and HIV can now start to replicate within the host cell. Now, to understand how an HIV fusion inhibitor works, let's focus on the two key regions involved in the GP41 folding, HR1 and HR2. It's the folding of the HR1 region back onto the HR2 region that causes these two elements to bind together like Velcro. You can imagine, as shown in this inset on the left, that the binding of these HR1 and HR2 regions will pull the HIV and host membranes closer together. The HIV fusion inhibitor enfuretide is a 36 amino acid synthetic peptide that mimics the HR2 region. Enfuretide basically has the same amino acid sequence as the HR2 region, minus a few amino acids on either end. Since enfuvertide is an HR2 lookalike, it will bind to the HR1 region. Envuvertide prevents the normal folding and binding of the HR1 and HR2 regions. It thus prevents the fusion of the HIV and host cell membranes. Envuvertide is the only available fusion inhibitor. Like most small synthetic amino acid peptide compounds, envuvertide cannot be taken orally. It's administered as a twice-daily subcutaneous injection. This twice-daily injection requirement has been the primary rate-limiting step for the use of envuvertide. Let's finish with a brief review and summary of the four HIV entry inhibitor medications. As I have outlined, there are two HIV entry inhibitors that bind directly to HIV, and both of these target the HIV envelope glycoprotein. As shown on the left side of this image, the attachment inhibitor temsivir binds to the HIV GP120 and blocks attachment of the HIV envelope to the host cell CD4 receptor. As shown on the right side, envuvertide is a fusion inhibitor that binds to GP41 and prevents the fusion of HIV and host cell membranes. In contrast, two of the HIV entry inhibitors work by binding to host cell surface receptors. As shown on the left, the post-attachment inhibitor ibalizumab binds to the host CD4 receptor and prevents the movement of HIV GP120 that is needed for co-receptor binding. As shown on the right, the CCR5 antagonist maraviroc binds to the host CCR5 receptor and blocks binding of the HIV GP120 to the CCR5 co-receptor. So in summary, I've reviewed the three main steps involved in HIV entry: CD4 attachment, co-receptor binding, and fusion. And I've also reviewed the corresponding four subclasses of HIV entry inhibitors: attachment inhibitors, post-attachment inhibitors, CCR5 antagonist, and fusion inhibitors. And last, I reviewed the four HIV entry inhibitors, one for each of these entry inhibitor subclasses. I hope this overview has provided you with some insights on the HIV entry inhibitor class of medications. Thank you.
The production of this National HIV Curriculum Mini-Lecture was supported by grant U10HA32104 from the Health Resources and Services Administration of the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. Its contents are solely the responsibility of the University of Washington IDEA Program and do not necessarily represent the official views of HRSA or HHS.